basis. Thank you very, very much for coming out. Thank you to the 13 offenders. We appreciate you being here. We are, or where our art is, Fuse. So we're a conversation between an audience and an artist. We talk about business, we talk about process, and it's really about the connections. We want to make connections between people. Can we go to the next slide? These are the people that are working on Gilded. My name is Chris Chapankel. I'm going to be your MC-esque type of person here. This is Luis Garcia. And then we have Sebastian Smith in the back. So he'll be filming and catching your good side. So just a quick thank you to our sponsors. And you can read all of those right there. We can go ahead and move on to the next one. So we'll talk briefly about our format. We have two presenters. One presenter will give approximately a 6-minute talk, and then we will open up the floor to a Q&A. And we really want you to encourage you during the talk to think about things, you know, questions about how you do this or why you're doing that. And at the end, we like to ask about challenges. So also, if the artist gives you challenges, think about that and see if you come up with something for that. We are going to have a brief announcement from the Kansas City Library in between the two presenters today. And do we have our upcoming events on here by any chance?
We do not.
Okay. You can go to gilded.org. You can check out our calendar. We have a lot of great presenters coming on, and we also have a really amazing event at the Casey Library coming up. It's sci-fi storytellers. So we have a sci-fi filmmaker, and then we also have a comic book writer, the creator of the Female Four, and they're both going to be presenters.
Okay.
That's why I was hoping that the calendar was up. Because I don't know it right off the top of my head. Do you know the date for that one by any chance? The sci-fi storytellers? Otherwise, I'll need to look it up. I'll get that date for you.
See what I'm going to work.
Yep. So let's go ahead and go to our first presenter. Jason Pollan is accepted internationally in 3 continents. He has been on the faculty of the Royal College of Art in London, Parsons School of Design, and Pratt Institute before serving as KCI's fire chair for 13 years.
Please. Can you hear me okay? Is this good? Okay, the world was, I guess, created in 7 days, so I can present a little life in 6 minutes, right? I don't know why. I don't have an inner clock that says 6 minutes, but I hear something ticking, so I better get on with it. So, this is about a relationship between, in a sense, making money and being an artist. And I was a very poor artist in New York City, went to graduate school, moved to Paris, where I'm half French, so I moved to Paris, and couldn't survive painting portraits on the street, and became a textile designer because I could draw and paint. And that then paid the bills for me to be able to continue my passion to make art, which I saw as quite separate from design at that time. Oh, well, that's strange. Next one? No? No video? What?
Looks like we're maybe loading.
What? It's loading? Okay, well, in case it doesn't come up here, this is why I wanted to do it with my own technology. I have a show up at this moment at 2020 Baltimore MLB Designs Gallery. And it's been extended until a week from tomorrow, so first Friday in February. And the brochures that are for you give the information about what that show is about. Does it look like this won't happen? We don't know? Okay. Well, I can't seem to move forward with a forward button here. And it's probably 3 minutes. I was just telling some folks here, I was invited to Scotland last year, and at 2 universities, they couldn't present my work. So I went to 2 cities in Scotland, they never could connect the cable and the projector to either my thumb drive or my laptop. So these things happen. Anyway, process. In 1966 in Paris, I ran out of money, and the first non-painting I ever did was collecting twigs in the forest and putting them onto non-gessoed canvas. And that has led to the most recent work earth, which are my descendants, they're on the right, and also they're supposed to move, but doesn't look like they will. In any case, both of these works are in the show, so the ancestors on the left and the descendants, there we go. And so that is my great passion and love at this moment. I am making lots of them. The play of light and shadow and movement is a big departure from where I was before. And well, I'll talk to you about Zahner in a minute and its relationship to that work. Okay, business strategies. So the good news is my entire life I've been trying to figure out a way to work with social media, kicking and screaming. But fortunately, I have an employee now who was first an intern last semester and now my employee. She's a junior in the FICA department. She's right there. She's Diana Lerma. And because, yes, please applaud her. I mean, she is now my Saint Diana, you know. And I mean, everything is happening because of that. In any case, in terms of pricing of work, yes, there's a bullet there about according to past sales, when you reach a certain plateau during a career, you tend to not want to go below that or jump too high above it unless you become the great star, which is not happening right now. So anyway, I also had the good fortune living in Kansas City after, I never thought I'd live here, but since I started teaching and stayed, I was able to start a mat company, and being the world's worst businessman, it failed miserably. No, not entirely. Actually, it did very well, except that the company that produced them, which is the is Golden Star, Gary Greninger's company here, in Atchison, we were able to print these things out onto. These are the kinds of floor mats that you see in places like this that usually either have a logo but no fine design. So we did that, but then he decided not to make mats anymore and I wasn't willing to try to do this in China. So that came and went. The wonderful thing of being a big fish in a little pond, if I dare call myself that at all, is that you get to know people that are not necessarily the kinds of people you might not run into in New York or Paris so easily. So Bill Zahner and I worked on set design for the Kansas City Ballet, and that was a great revelation for me. Wonderful. I've never worked large scale. And now, so, oh yes, okay, goals. Reaching high-end designers, you can see exhibition venues, marketing large scale. So I'm thinking of doing digital prints, maybe of some of my work, if that pans out. I'm talking to a couple of CEOs here to see if we can make that happen. But in the meantime, we are making translations of the descendants in metal, a much larger scale than what we have now, that I have now. And those will be, for sale at the PCAI auction in June. So I'm really happy to be working with Meg Zahner and Bill Zahner and Sean Kelly on that project. And, okay, so needs. So this is more about the community, which this should have been about all along anyway. And what else can we do in Kansas City to stimulate greater communication between the business and the arts community. And I think some of these we do already and can always do more. I think the possibility of more internships, mentorships, the more the better. Paid internships should really be on the table. I think a lot of companies that don't pay their interns are doing themselves and certainly the interns a disservice because of what the interns bring to the table. I think we could have a lot better art criticism in Kansas City. And so if you know anybody who is wanting to do that, I have how many minutes left? One. Oh, I have a whole minute. So integration of visual performing, performance-based arts, I think some of that's happening again. This seems to be an age of collaboration, and it's a wonderful thing for all parties concerned to stretch beyond their own medium into other realms. So, thank you. So, yes. go sale. So a week after my show closes next Friday, I will be having a sale at Open My Studio. And of course, you're all welcome. I'm on Facebook now, on Instagram, and I know these things. It's all her fault, or because of her. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Jason, if you'd like to stay at the front here, I think the...
Well, we're going to do this one on the picture.
Do the Q&A. So if anybody has any questions...
Please have a question.
Comments.
And yes, I am a tango teacher, and yes, next week from Friday, I will be giving a free tango lesson at the gallery from 7 to 8. Argentine tango. Very creative. Sure. Okay, questions?
So...
Answers?
Paul, do you have a question? We only have one microphone, so I'm going to ask you.
Oh, okay.
I can project.
And I meet you. I was familiar with your relations from a golden star. Is that you, Jerry Clayton?
Yes.
And I knew that in many ways I was very successful while it lasted. I was always surprised that there were more businesses in Kansas City that understood how creative artists are good to help inject that kind of creativity and imagination into product design. Well, I was surprised that there weren't very many people who adopted that. What's your perspective or maybe insight into what those challenges are and what we might do to encourage more of that kind of business and artist collaboration?
It's a wonderful question. I love the question.
The question really basically is, how do we get more businesses to interface with artists to create maybe things that are not familiar to them and as a pattern of way and a way of working, which I think a lot of this has to do with time, that people see, we live in a world in which time seems to be indelibly tied to money. And I always knew from a very early age that I would always choose time over money. And people said it was unrealistic, but in fact, it turned out to be extremely realistic in my case, and everybody has a different path. But I know that lots of business people are so pressured into getting their doing what they have to do on a daily basis, that they don't leave that time. And that's not true in Europe. In Europe, a lot of people open their doors to creative people because it gives them an awareness of things going on that they don't see every day. And then the light might go on. The only reason I did these mats was I asked Gary Gradinger if anybody had ever done high design on industrial mats, and he said, no, there'd be no market for it. And I said, well, could we try one? And that led to hundreds of them in hundreds of stores and museum shops and so on. So I think there are many, many people who could do that here. And I think if we could all be emissaries out in the world to kind of not say, hey, why don't you work with her? You can't imagine what you'd be able to achieve, you know, in a connection with this person. At least build that into part of your model, your business model. Again, I'm not a businessman, but somehow it happened anyway. So thanks for the question.
It seems that might actually relate, interestingly, to your work with Zahner, because it seems like Zahner is kind of stepping into that position in Kansas City. Could you comment on that?
Yes, I think that Bill Zahner is, you know, one of the great people in Kansas City in so many, very many ways. And he is very stimulated by working with creative people. He will take a chance. It's about a risk and a chance. And some people are risk averse and they won't do it. And other people like Bill sort of embrace it fully. And it also even ends, it becomes not just a practical or a creative endeavor, it often becomes a friendship, a lasting friendship. I feel with the Zahner family, I'm now really deeply connected. It isn't for out of self-interest or It is, it just feels right. It feels very humanistic in the best way.
Ask them to stand up.
Sorry?
Ask them to stand up.
Stand up. Oh, that's Christian. He is standing up. any other questions? Yes.
Just really just a comment. I'm not an artist. I'm the librarian guy who's going to be talking in a few minutes, but I was just sort of a thought suggestion. Is that my awareness is that the theater, the performing arts community in Kansas City is flourishing right now also, and I'm just thinking about whether, and I guess I'm referring to you and anyone else in the room, whether there have any attempts or any relationships to be forged between, what I'm thinking is that, I'm not sure that all, I'm thinking about the different theater performance spaces in town, and that a lot of them, I don't think, have lobbies, et cetera, that could be used as exhibit space. I was just thinking about whether that might be something worth exploring. Like I said, I'm referring to you and anyone else who wants to think about this, in part of that would just create a little bit more creative synergy of, just a thought.
All right, good. She has a question.
Do you see that phenomenon of not hiring artists as a direct correlation to losing a lot of young artists in Kansas City?
Losing a lot of artists?
I feel like we lose young artists at a higher rate than a lot of big cities because we don't have some of the more sufficient ways for them to grow in business. Is that time and money?
Yeah, in a sense, in a way, I almost don't agree with you entirely. I think
a lot of people, especially my connection with the Art Institute, that a lot of people who come here, of course, would love to move to San Francisco or New York or Paris or London and so on. But to be able to do that takes enormous resources. And also, if you often are in a very tiny space. Whereas in Kansas City, when students do stay here, they have many more resources, and also there's a very supportive community here. I think that I see a lot of my own students over the many, many decades that I taught here are doing very, very well here. One in particular, Deborah Smith, who moved to Brooklyn, didn't quite work out the way she had hoped, although some good things happened, but back here she's flourishing. And I know many, many people have done that. Some have achieved success in the bigger cities, and of course it's great if you can do that. But I think realistically, as a plan B, let's say, this is certainly a good place to immerse oneself as an artist. But I think everybody should get out of here and go somewhere else and experience the rest of the world. And that is certainly that.
Yeah. Oh.
Just as a quick follow-up to that, the research shows that the net result of artists moving and coming to Kansas City has been positive. Pretty much every year over the last decade or so, except for right around the recession, in the worst year of the recession. So there's actually a significantly higher number of independent artists, writers, and performers living here now than there were in 2002.
Just a quick comment about that. In the 30 plus years that I've been here, the arts community in Kansas City has really flourished in a way I certainly didn't expect in 1983 when I first came. The performing arts, the Kauffman Center, this school, which is, you know, a school, what the Nelson has achieved. I mean, I think this is a continuing embracing of the arts and seeing it as an enormous contribution to a city for the vitality and meaningfulness of the people who live in the city. Anybody else before we let our other illustrious guests speak?
I actually had a question.
Yeah.
Kind of along these same lines. I have ties in the theater community, and I often hear that in the theater they're able to take risks here that they can't take in other places because theater rents are cheaper and home rents are cheaper, cost of living is cheaper. Has that affected you in any way, living in Kansas City?
I'm not sure. That the
lower costs of living and creating allows you to take bigger risks.
Oh, absolutely. I certainly couldn't have a house with a studio that I have in New York City. I lived on the 32nd floor of a high rise, but there was really very little room for creativity to happen in that space. And what I do see is people like groups like the Owen Cox Dance Company. You know, they're really reaching out and embracing other artists to create visuals for them. And I think they are a perfect example of being able to afford what they certainly couldn't afford in other bigger cities. Mm-hmm. So yeah, definitely.
Well, we do have one more question over here.
Sure.
I'll bring you up.
I just wanted to react to what was just said. Perhaps it's the case, though, that the cost of living in Kansas City is going up. And is that a consideration for artists with the Google Fiber, you know, the streetcar, and general growth?
Must be. I mean, I think for all of us, sure, when if you don't have a salary that sort of increases along with the cost of living, that becomes a problem for everybody, and certainly artists who often don't have a 9-to-5 job and they are relying on sales. It's of course always a problem. But these cycles come and go all the time. It's a precarious work. Being an artist is not for sissies.
I have one final question. It's kind of our gilded question.
Yes.
And that is, what can those of us in this room right now and in the larger community do to help you achieve your goals in your art, in your life?
Oh, I want you to achieve the next generation's goals. I am so grateful to what has come my way here. But I really want to do everything possible for people who aren't in the position that I'm in now and who had great good luck along the way. And so I think in any way that we can do, we can help and spread the word, that's what we need to do. And I'll be out there waving the flag. Okay, thank you all.
Thank you very much. Where we can talk and network, and you can certainly talk to Jason afterwards. It'll be interesting and fun. I do want to take a moment to invite Eric Peterson. He's going to make an announcement for the library.
And I saw I didn't bring enough of my own business cards, so about half of you have my card, and the other half of you have the card for the HR Block Business and Career Center. I'm at the Central Library downtown. The Kansas City Public Library has a business and career center on the third floor of the Central Library. And for those of you who don't have my card, I want to give you at least my phone number. Again, I'm Eric Peterson. My direct number is 816-701-3645. I'll give that to you again in a couple minutes. And I want to give you that information because, like I said, this business and career center that we have is one of the services we provide is research databases, et cetera, for entrepreneurs, information about demographics, industry, your market, et cetera. And we help entrepreneurs, just like yourself, just like artists, try to get the word out about your, in this case, it would be your creative endeavors. And we help all sorts of businesses, and I've helped artists many times. I actually have a colleague, a full-time colleague, who also is our nonprofit specialist. We also help people who are wanting to get grants for funding for things like art endeavors. And I can give you his information if you drop me a line. But I just wanted you to be aware that there is a free service that the library offers to help you grow, expand, and sort of navigate the changing and challenging business landscape here in town. So again, my name is Eric Peterson, and we do consultations. That's why I want to give you my phone number, why to be with me in person. Again, my number is 816-701-3645. Thank you very much for your time, and thank you for all you do to support the creative arts community in Kansas City.
Thank you, Eric. I do have the date. That's Thursday, February 16th. It's at the downtown library. There's a reception that begins at 6 o'clock, and the presentation will start at 6:30. We actually have the 30 minutes before is where we will do our networking. So please come early and meet the two presenters. Okay, so let me find my next intervention, please. All right. So KCAI professor and sculptor Michael Wickerson has exhibited throughout North America and in Holland. He also is a co-director of a private studio and sculptural landscape. In 2014, Wickerson's digital analog Fire Over Kansas was displayed simultaneously in venues around the world. Please.
Playheads in bronze faces. Alternative partnerships included international photo shoots and publications. In 2013, I worked with JR Imageworks at Naked Architecture from Holland as a collaborator and project manager. We produced a series of digital analog prints entitled Fire Over Kansas and received international recognition. These prints have been shown in Utrecht, Holland, Krakow, Poland, and most recently, Brooklyn, New York. I'm sorry if these are first-time views for people. I'm not really leaving the time to look at them. We can go back. Most recently, I've completed a collaboration and booklet called Vasilisa the Beautiful, a new seasonal photo series with photographer Joe McKeever, who happens to be the owner of Four Strange Women Perfumery downtown. Here are a few of the images that were generated. In 2014, Cinema KC video broadcasted Fisher of Men in season 4, episode 4, an 11-minute video documentary of Wickerson Studios created by VHTV, a company out of Kansas. I have always continued to exhibit. Recent artworks and exhibitions include Some of Us Do Not Belong Indoors at a gallery called The New Gallery, past Tompkins Projects Gallery in Brooklyn, New York, and that ran in July last year, and recently sent piece that I made is the fiery piece on the far right, in Undercooked in Barbecue LA, Los Angeles, in November last year. As you probably see, my hobbies include creating annual architectural follies. 2009, Isabella. Hamlet's Mill in 2010, and the Greek Foundry to the far right in 2011. Moby Dick in 2012. Little Otick in 2013. Fisher of Men in 2014, and Herdra, which has been one of my most profitable buildings I've ever made, is an entire wood gas kiln, fires once a month. Vasilisa the Beautiful was built in November, in 1 month, by taking part in the Reef Foundry. These landscape buildings have supported me in hosting several distinct and interesting events, including the International Sculpture Day, which I'll do again this year, Global Obscura Day, and the first and second scheduled annual Wickerson Studios Sculptor Gathering, which I'm timing for the end of the International Sculpture Conference this fall. Expected outcomes at this point in my life, as I make the transition from mid-career artist and associate professor to professional artist and entrepreneur, I find myself focused more and more on commissioned activities. I have been encouraged by friends, family, and colleagues outside of KCAI to engage in better business practices as a professional artist. My efforts have been incredibly rewarding and I have expanded over the years. I remain committed to exploring the universal connections that exist between the art world and the world at large and the business world. Life is not what one achieves, rather, it is more about who one inspires. Currently, I choose to inspire these three individuals in my life. I don't waste an ounce of daylight. It won't get done on its own. As for what it is, I don't particularly know. And if you can provide any semblance as to what you see here, I welcome your ability to yield. Thank you.
Are hosting an awful lot of events, and I'll be back at school seeing what events are happening. I imagine I'll have some casting role, or Fab Lab role, or workshop role. That is a Kansas City thing, not just a Kansas City Art Institute. I have followed the International Sculpture Conference, but I did not attend this year at their most recent one. I think those questions would be best asked to maybe somebody over in the sculpture department currently that's bringing that together. I can ask, answer, try to answer a specific question, but I'm just telling you, I've been out of the loop on that a little bit.
That sounds really amusing.
It should be fun, and I will say I'm ending with a 2-day stopover on my land in Kansas City, Kansas. Many alum that can't afford to go there or just want to come back to Kansas City and spend time itself and open itself up pretty much publicly for people to gather once again. And I do. We had a wonderful time a year ago. I'm going to try and do that every 2 years. And I thought that might be off the grid outside of Kansas City. It's such a rushed event. Place for people to kind of hang out after Saturday when it's over and maybe into Sunday. So I'm excited to do my part in the band camp.
But how do people know about your events that you have out there?
I will put them on Facebook and Wickerson Studios and Instagram recently, even though that's been swamped with information of me going around with my kids. And it's not very, but what's happened is I have done so many events, including having artists out, interns, visiting artists. Our last one that was advertised is really through the artist that does the project. And Tom Montagliano did a tour all the way to Burning Man. I think it was 22 states in 21 days. And he did his soundscapes. And we had him do a soundscape in an inflatable igloo on our land. And he did all of the advertisement for that. He pulled in probably about 60 to 80 people for that event. And that's anybody from my midwife to Kelly Daniels, a friend and activist in the city that knows my wife, any homeschoolers that I hang out with, anybody from KCAI. Those events are very spontaneous and on the schedule, and I was very glad he showed up the day that it was actually going to happen. He's on a tour state by state. That was a very unique experience, but I have worked everywhere between individuals to granting certificate degrees to others. And Will Bradley recently, he has an alternative school for the visual arts at my home, which we celebrated in a very informal way. I don't say no man.
So, how would you say that teaching at KCAI has impacted Wickerson under?
It has had a huge influence. I came here with very little knowledge. I knew how to work within a very controlled foundry environment of the Odette Sculpture Center at York University. When I came here, I experienced what this facility was and what you could do. And I've taken an awful lot of the dated, older technologies. I've taken my skills that I've gathered. The wood kiln was assembled and fabricated there. I learned a lot just by trial and error. And a lot of the processes that remain there aren't ones that are really conducive for the city in the city limits. Now, I'm in the city limits in Kansas, but we have different rules out there, it seems. And I enjoy it very much. But we definitely, it had huge influence on what I wanted to keep. The foundry, the iron casting, the bronze aluminum, which still exists at KCAI. But it's a much more controlled and computerized kind of system and instruction system. I really try and time myself to full moon and make sure there's an activity happening there, season or month. It's a huge influence on who I am as an artist, but as for KCAI, there have been, and there was a mention, I've had my first apprentice, Roland Foster, who's in the crowd for last semester, who was there. I've had several directed studies, several interns, and I'm moving more and more towards working directly with artists and their ideas and what they want to bring out. Kat Dyson, an alumni from years back, has 2 degrees in psychology, and she's coming to do an artist residency this spring coming up, and she's booked herself to film my kiln and do some castings with me. We will do that when she gets here. Mm-hmm. It's chaotic, but it was more chaotic at 65.
I'm interested in your documentation.
The documentation
for your work is beautiful.
Thank you, and I cannot take credit for it. My wife does an awful lot of it, but I have hired and brought in individuals like Joe McKeever and Yara Brodich to professionally do those series. Those are their works.
So, does that then contribute any revenue to your practice?
If they sold, yes. There is a booklet on several books on Blur and where we try and publish things that do happen. Usually revenues like these soundscapes was cash in the pocket to the artist that evening of, and he made quite a bit of money. I didn't lose any money in the process in offering the land. I do not have a pressing, I have the luxury now, for the first time in my life, to not have a pressure that everything I do that needs to generate an income, and that has only been very recent since December. That is swinging into, but with that comes the responsibility of three children, and so there's a great trade-off in that. I do definitely value. I don't do things for free, so I do work for artists and other companies, and I'm very, and those are, I think, competitive commissions. And when I do work for Metal Labs, they pay very well, and I do an awful lot of work for them. But I get the, I can pick and choose a little bit what's happening there. So, but I would say I came into the visual arts out of math through Buster Keaton and the Millay brothers in film studies and mysticism, magic, and then occult was the other elective. But when I saw these studios that were popping up and I realized mine could be a backdrop, I will tear a building down and build another thing if you need it 1 month later. And I have, it is a ruin upon ruins in only 7 years out on Kansas City, Kansas. And I have a, we do have a new exhibition planned. It is Oscar and Max's great outdoor permanent sculpture installation opening this summer forever.
Do we have any more questions here? All right.
So you mentioned the Pullman. When should we expect them at the Pullman?
I have enough pieces to load into that kiln. Weather is a great defining factor as well, but I am ready. Yes. When is it? I can load that kiln in a day, no problem. It's a 1 day fire heat up with wood. It fires with gas only, propane. It's a, quite an experience. It takes 12 hours and I've got it down. For those who haven't experienced it, it's pretty memorable. She is called Herdra. She is called Herdra. That's the kiln that's been named after two artists that have put pieces in the kiln.
Is the punk folks still community aware?
A little bit, and I would wish they would finally broadcast the fourth season of Cinema KC. Anything I did, the HTV put the film into film, but they wouldn't give me the rights to it, and it's Bryce Bandwin's work. So when I work with others, I really have, I've had the aerial photographs done, I've had the drones tested. I'm not a very good businessman, and maybe I could end with this. My co-director is on. Beth Allison Wickerson works at Sullivan and Sink. For those who really are up for a challenge, I'm looking for a co-director, if not a director of Wickerson Studios. That begins now.
It does seem like some of the video and the
VHTV came out after Fire Over Kansas was on KC Studio, and they wanted to do this, and it was an intern's opportunity to impress them to be hired by them. And he did an incredible job, a young graduate from KCAI, Bryce Bedlin, and like I said, it's all, it's gone off, and he has grown because of it, and I'm just the backdrop for it. And it's been fantastic. And I've seen people come and go on my land, I've seen people who have helped me work pass away on my land within 7 years. There's a history there that if you take a walk with me, every single artifact, piece of stone or fabric, I can name it in place. And yeah, kids can do it as well. It's quicker, some studio and daughter fellow. Thank you for having me here.
So we wrapped up a little bit early today. Please do feel free to hang out and talk to the artists, talk to one another.
There's still more coffee back here, too.
Plenty of coffee.
Surveys?
Yes, there's a survey. That we would appreciate. And we'd also very much appreciate seeing you back here at the next one. Have a great day.